Have you ever been burgled? Burgled. Someone breaks into your house and steals your stuff. Not robbed. Robbed is when someone threatens you. Yeah, but the actual burglarized. Yeah, you could say that. I like burgled better. If you're gonna be stolen from, may as well be fun to talk about. Jamie and I have been burgled before. Can't call it breaking and entering because we didn't lock the door. I forgot it. So the guy who lives next door to us walked into our home and stole a bunch of Jamie's costume jewelry and a bunch of my Christian CDs. And then he decided he thought it would be really fun to go into our bathroom and steal prescription medication, which has our names all over it. He was pretty easy to catch, because my response upon being burgled is, oh no, there's someone in the area who's prone to walk into your home. So my first response is, of course, call the police, and then second is to knock on the doors around us and warn everybody. So I knock on the door and my neighbor invites me in to talk with him about the fact that someone burgled and my medication is sitting on his table. So when the police showed up, I said, oh, it's that guy. How do you know? Well, he's not a smart burglar. Home security systems make a big deal on how to deal with fear to sell you their product. I guess they don't feel that most people are going to go out and find the person responsible themselves. Actually, come to think of it, the both times that I've been stolen from, once at home and once at a church I worked at, I called around to all of the thrift stores and I found the guy. I found my stuff. And so I called the police and told them, oh, well, yeah, I was stolen from, and this is the guy who did it, and this is where he lives, and this is where my stuff is. I did all the work for them, and they decided not to press charges. So security systems become kind of attractive. You know, that's about preparing for something that you don't want to happen. But what about preparing for something you do want? If you would turn in your Bibles with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Last week we talked about how the Thessalonian church dealt with death, which was an unwanted thing, and today Paul writes to them and describes how to deal with a sudden thing that they do want. He's specifically returning to the return of the Lord. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we'll start at verse 1 and we'll look at the 11 verses. So this is all about preparing for the positive surprise. Let's read the first 5 verses. Now brothers, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come upon them suddenly as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers, are not in darkness so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all sons of the light and sons of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. The two things that we do when we are preparing for a positive surprise. This holds true for birthday parties. This holds true for Christmas time, holidays that you're going to spend. It also holds true for the day of the Lord, which you might not necessarily think of as a positive surprise, but it really is. All of the frustration with life, gone. We get to be with Jesus. That's a huge woohoo, yes. So, how do we prepare for a positive surprise. There's two things. We start now to get ready. We start now to get ready. I can tell in my own home that my mother-in-law is due to arrive before I've ever been told she's going to arrive. Because the house starts to get cleaner. And I am enlisted in this process. And when I start to wonder, well, why are we doing it? Oh, mom's coming. Okay. We start now to get ready. In verses 1 and 2, Paul writes the Thessalonians, and by us, by extension, and says, don't worry about the arrival time. He says right up front, about times and dates, we do not need to write you. Jesus has this same conversation with his disciples. One time he sits them all down and he describes what the destruction of Jerusalem is going to look like. I believe this is Mark 13, if you wanted to look it up. And he's saying, well, and his disciples, when is this going to happen, Lord? And he says, about times and dates, you don't need to worry. You just need to watch and be ready. And you could pray that it doesn't happen in winter, because the idea is that you're going to need to get out of town as quick as you possibly can. We are not to focus on times and dates as we are waiting for Christ to arrive. And why that's important is because whether we like to admit it or not, our Christian subculture sells a lot of books right now based on the idea that you don't know when Jesus is going to come, and so you've always got to be ready. But when you see this happen, he could be right around the corner. When this happens, it could be right around the corner. Ministries have risen and fallen based on trying to pick a date. Jesus is going to return on this day. Remember a few years ago, maybe 4 or 5 years ago now, there was a guy, Harold Camping, who was absolutely sure Jesus was coming back on such and such a day. He had a radio ministry. He told everybody. He got a whole bunch of people to agree. Yep. We think Jesus is coming back on such and such a day. People were selling their homes. They were traveling all around the country saying, you need to be ready. Rapture's coming on this particular day. The day comes. The day goes. Harold's radio show goes silent. He comes back out in a few weeks and says, I may have miscalculated. It's a couple of months from now. That day comes and goes. Harold's radio show goes off the air. It is not our job as followers of Jesus to fixate on days or times. Jesus is very clear. No one's going to know the day or the time. So, this is how my mind works. As soon as I hear somebody say, it's on this day, it's like, well, it might have been if you had kept your mouth shut. But now we know it's not going to be that. Whatever day it's going to be, it's not that day, because you had to go and say something. We aren't to be focused on times. We focus on the valuable. We focus on the value. You know very well the day is going to come like a thief in the night. So the time isn't the important thing. Look at verse 3. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come upon them suddenly as labor pains on a pregnant woman. They won't escape. And I want you to notice that Paul is telling the Thessalonians that destruction is going to come upon those who are not prepared. He's not saying destruction is going to come upon these people who already love Jesus. We don't need to worry about God's wrath. He has called us into his family. He has said, you are mine. Therefore, you escape wrath. That's not what you're here for. So the destruction is because there are some people who refuse to prepare. They refuse to admit that there is an invitation for them. And then, for some reason, Paul puts in my opinion, a very silly image. He puts in an image of a pregnant woman who is ignoring oncoming labor pains. I notice the women are starting to laugh more than the men. I have never seen a woman have a labor pain and have her go, "Oh, that's a bad taco." It just doesn't happen. When a labor pain comes, that's when, honey, it's time to go. It's doctor, we're doctor bound. It's time. And of course, the young husband, and I was this, "Are you sure? Are you sure?" "Yes, get in the car." "Okay. Let go of my lower lip and off we'll go." The church knows to focus on the value. The church knows that we are waiting with anticipation for Christ to come. This is a good thing. It's a ridiculous idea that knowing that Christ is coming and to not prepare for it. That's why this is here in verse 3. Verses 4 and 5. "You, brothers, are not in darkness, so this day should surprise you like a thief. You're sons of the light and sons of the day. We don't belong to the night or the darkness." Remember, God puts his light in us. Darkness isn't an active thing that overcomes light. Darkness is just the absence of light. We focus on the valuable. We wait for God to come. We shine. And when we shine his light in us, it dispels the darkness. He's telling the Thessalonians this as a way of reminding them, you're doing what you're supposed to be doing. Remember, they were a little freaked out. They had heard differing reports on, well, maybe Jesus has come and left them behind, or maybe they're not really ready, or they were unsure. He's like, no, you are doing what you're supposed to be doing. You are loving people, you are serving people, you are letting your light so shine so that people see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Jesus' own words, Matthew 5:16. Start now to get ready for this eventual return when Jesus will come. When will it happen? We don't know. Paul kind of implies we shouldn't even care. It doesn't matter whether Jesus returns today or tomorrow or the next day or pick an odd Thursday or 200 years from now. Our responsibilities to love people, to love God and love our neighbor don't change. So let's just get going. We start now to get ready. And the other thing is, we stay on guard. We stay on guard. Let's look at verses 6 through 11. "So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing." we stay on guard. Verse 6 talks about, let us not be like others. That means that we choose to be aware. We choose to be aware. I remember a trip I was on with Rachel and a bunch of her little friends, where the school took us all out to go look at the windmills, the power generating windmills. And as we were driving along and I'm looking at the strata in the hillside, I pointed at that and asked Rachel, Rachel, do you see the lines in the dirt? And she says, yeah. I said, why do you think that happened? And she looked at it and she figured out, well, it's probably because of they are different layers that have gathered over time. That's right. So we talked about sedentary rock and talked about the process by where, you know, geology, that stuff happens. And she's sitting next to a friend of hers, and her little friend mouth drops open. How do you know that? I said, well, I study this kind of stuff. But why? Because I want to know why things happen the way they happen. Well, how did you... She wasn't curious about the world at all. And so the idea of looking for an answer for why a thing is the way it is was absolutely alien to her. Of course, because I'm that kind of geeky person, the girls have kind of turned out to be that person. So Rachel was right with it. Oh, yeah, sure. We do this all the time. We're always looking at things. We choose to be aware. Verses 7 and 8, let's look at this. This is interesting to me. Those who sleep, sleep at night. And those who drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to today, let us be self-controlled, putting on faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. We gird ourselves. I searched for quite some time to find a word that I liked better than gird, and I just couldn't find it. So we don't really put on armor anymore. That's not a thing that we do very often. But the Romans, when they would put on armor, they put on a tunic that went underneath everything, and then over the top of that they have this belt, and the belt has holes in it, places that things can be tied to it. So when the armor is put on piece by piece, it's almost laced together over the person, and then it's hooked into the belt. They gird themselves. They prepare for war piece by piece, very intentionally. Now, this isn't really about warfare per se. This is more like a person who's going to go accomplish a task that they know takes special equipment. Now, I could be wrong here, but I've been reading a lot, and apparently you're not supposed to wear sandals if you're gonna go muck out a stall someplace. I don't know. I had had a conversation, almost a fairly forceful one, that if I were ever going to go muck out a stall, this was one of you, I won't mention who it was, but you wanted to make sure I knew that, by golly, you need to get good cowboy boots on, and that you aren't supposed to tuck your jeans into the cowboy boots, because you're supposed to put foot, sock, and then cowboy boot, and then the jeans come down over the cowboy. You're gonna get your jeans messy. It's gonna be gross. But the idea is to keep your feet from getting gross. You gird yourself to go muck out a stall. Does that make sense? You take on a very intentional set of equipment to make sure that you're able to do the work that you're called to do. That's what Paul is saying here. We gird, we put on faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. Why? Verse 9, God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation. You see, Jesus has already won. Jesus wins. We're on his team, and the battle is won. The amount of playing time we get doesn't matter. I love watching our football team play. Usually for about the first half, and then I'm kind of done. But what I do notice is that there's a whole bunch of guys who aren't working very hard, watching a much smaller amount of people who are working hard. But all of those guys, they're all suited up. And when the team moves downfield, they don't stay. They walk all the way down. They're watching right there, just in case the coach says, okay, I need you to go in for that person. They're ready. And when the football team makes the touchdown, the guys who are on the field score. The guys who are off the field cheer. And they say, we scored. I'm sitting usually behind the pep band. And when the guys in the football team score, we yell, we scored. I'd score. I had squat to do with it. I'm not even playing, you know, Jamie will occasionally sit in with the pep band. I'm not even there. I'm just behind him, shivering. But I'm not doing anything, but we scored. Because it's all our team, right? Think about it this way. It doesn't matter what you are called to do in the kingdom. You are on Christ's team, and Christ has won. We scored. We win. Jesus wins and we're on his coattails. That's how it works. That's what salvation is. Verse 10, he died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, alive or dead, we may live together with him. We are destined to win. Our current state doesn't make that much of a difference. And so verse 11 is where the rubber comes down to the road here. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up just as in fact you are doing. Why would he put that here? Because here is the truth of it. And if you haven't heard anything else in the sermon, hear this. In fact, you might want to look around, nudge everybody else, and make sure everybody's awake. This is the piece I want you to make sure you take home. Here it is. Encouragement leaks. Encouragement leaks. The story's told of the man and wife who were married for 70 years, and she's just angry and bitter, and at the end of 70th anniversary, she confronts him and she's like, you never tell me you love me. He says, I told you when we got married. No, that does not, encouragement leaks. We gotta encourage one another regularly. Like, well, you know, I told you the gospel once, you should be fine. No, encouragement leaks. This is an ongoing task. Remember how Paul told them to encourage one another just a chapter ago? That's because encouraging one another is an ongoing task. So how do we do this? This is being on guard for someone else. This might not sound like a very spiritual discipline, but it really works. we schedule times to encourage one another. Our regular practice is to come on Sunday mornings, we sit, I look at the scripture, we all look through it together, and then we go in the other room and we encourage one another. Hey, how are you doing? In fact, that happens a little bit before service too. We check in on each other. When somebody's hubby is out of town, we check in on the person who's left. Hey, how are you doing? Can we help? I was sitting in my office this morning. I had a number of people just poking in. You doing okay? And all I could do at that point, I had no voice. We encourage each other because encouragement leaks. And so we schedule it. We make room in our lives to build each other up. We make time for each other. That is a spiritual value that's not necessarily a churchy type thing. That's the conversation you have passing each other in the grocery store. Hey, how you doing? Oh, fine. Really? You sure? Yeah, I'm sure. Okay, I just got to check. That's what we do for each other. We protect because we're getting ready for Christ's return. Let's pray. Lord, set us on this ongoing task. Help us to share our lives with each other and encourage one another until you return for us. Whether that's sooner or later, doesn't matter. Because you've called us to be on your team. We are destined to win. And that is a great source of encouragement. Help us to remember that in Jesus' name.